Tonight on Points North, we cast off with a couple of Vermonters who are bringing new life to the traditional Adirondack guideboat.
We revisit our story on the restoration of the Ticonderoga.
And we visit with businesswoman and food entrepreneur Mary Alice McKenzie.
Hi, and welcome to another edition of Points North. I'm Rob Mihalik.
And I'm Fran Stoddard.
You know, one of the pleasures of living or visiting here is to enjoy the outdoors.
Hiking, skiing, fishing, or road touring are just a few of the many options we have.
Along with hopping into your runabout, sea kayak, canoe, or guideboat?
Yep, Adirondack guideboat. Once a workboat that went out of fashion after a century of service, the guideboat is making a recreational comeback.
We caught up with a couple of Vermonters who have their hands on the oars of bringing back this traditional workhorse of our northern lakes.
The first time I was ever in a guideboat was the time that actually changed my life, if you would, and set my career goals. I was rowing on Shelburne Pond and there was a heavy stiff breeze, and it came clear to me that the guideboat was just such a superior performer over and above canoes that I had been in as a little kid, flailing away like mad and noticing that the shore never moved an inch. And I found that with a guideboat I could actually make serious headway.
I fell in love with the boat. I bought one at a yard sale, went to the Adirondack Museum, learned more about them, found Steve's name in a boat reference book, came over and met him. 2 weeks later, we were partners.
The original guideboats started around 1840 in direct response to the influx of people from New York City and various metropolitan areas coming up to the Adirondacks to go hunting and fishing. And in doing that, they hired themselves a guide for pennies a day, probably, and the guide developed this boat specific for that reason, and it evolved out of the need for such a craft. Also, there were many camps being developed at that time in the Adirondack Park region, and the guideboat became their pickup truck as a means of transportation to get from one camp to another. The roads weren't completely developed at that time, making a small craft desirable and a necessity in order to get around the Adirondack Park region.
These were originally work boats in the Adirondacks. They could carry a man and a dead moose. I've never used it for that purpose myself, but it could. They used them for deer hunting, for cargo transport. Some boats were church boats that the entire extended family would get into one of these boats, maybe 8, 10, 15 people, go to church, conduct services on the water. The minister would be out over the water at the church, and all the parishioners would be in their boats. My 11-year-old stepdaughter says she guesses they never said, "All rise." Steve and I have been in business for 3 years. He's been building these boats for 20 years. And developing the designs and preparing to go out into the world. Both of us, when we went into business together, felt like there were little mystical crystals in the air. It was like, boy, this feels like my other half.
Our boat has the best attributes of two of the major builders, J. Henry Rushton and the Grant Guideboat. It has a tumble home stem. It's very narrow entry, making it very efficient and speedy. And the Grant boat was more famous for its stability. Its midsection design is something that I took from and put it in the middle of the Rushton boat and made a boat that is, I feel, superior. And we've been testing it and racing it in the last couple of years, and we've come out more times than not the fastest guideboat amongst other guideboats.
He said it's half Grant and half Rushton. It's also all Steve.
This is a traditionally constructed Adirondack guideboat. I believe this particular one is from 1923. And you can see that the individual ribs, and there are two of them coming in from either side, have been sawn from the rootstock of the spruce tree as it curved and made its way into the soil. As a contemporary boat builder, we have gone to the use of epoxies and fiberglass, and doing that has enabled us to make a rib that actually goes gunwale to gunwale, and we can make a continuous lamination all the way across, as you can see, and bridge the gap. These ribs, we believe, are much stronger, and in our form of construction, we only need to put in half as many ribs as you see in this boat here. Inside this steam box are a number of spruce strips that we use to make the stems. They've been soaking, being steamed, for about an hour now. They're good and hot, and the substance known as lignate has softened up and made plastic. This is hot, by the way. And I have about a minute and a half to bend these into the proper shape. I had to kind of ease it in slowly, because a lot of times if you go too fast, it'll cause them to crack on you. This process of putting a strip on is something that in the traditional method of building this boat. A person might be able to put together a pair of strakes, as they called them on the older boats, in a day's time. And with this process, we'll be able to do maybe a third or as much as a half of the required surface area in a day's time. So this part of it is one of the things that is faster, and it's also I use the word accessible. It's a kind of process that is not nearly as difficult and as intricate as the older method of doing putting strips on the side of a guide boat. We find that we can build a boat in the neighborhood of 250 to 300 hours.
The bottom of this boat is only about 6 inches wide. All of the sweep of the boat is really side. But as the boat is more and more heavily loaded with people or cargo, the boat becomes bigger in the water. It tracks very straight, something canoes and kayaks don't do. They need to be able to slide sideways on the water. And with any kind of wind or current, they'll push the boat sideways. Sometimes people get in this boat and say, it's hard to turn. And I'll say back to him, what you mean is it wants to go straight. Move people. We did a show recently up in Burlington down the waterfront, and a minister from Stowe went out rowing in this boat, and he came back after 5 or 8 minutes of rowing, and he has his own rowing shell, and he said that, Brother Rosen, is a deeply spiritual boat.